such accidents happening before. Then their car battery died and the music stopped. She cursed and slammed the dashboard. Suddenly, she heard a thump followed by a scratching or tapping sound on the roof of the car. She told herself that it was probably a tree branch. It was windy that night, but it was a loud noise. So she kept still. Sound. The noise continued and her imagination began to play tricks on her. Was someone out there? Her fear continued to grow, but she didn't dare to open the door to escape. Just when she couldn't bear it any longer, flashing blue lights lit up the car and she breathed a sigh of relief, thinking that her date must have come back with some help. The car stopped and a policeman walked slowly son of the boy. The officer shined his torch through the window and beckoned her out of the car. "You're safe, but keep your eyes down and don't look back at the car," he instructed. Confused, the girl asked if the policeman had seen her date. "There's time for that later," came the reply. She opened the police door but could not resist a quick look back. What she saw made her freeze in terror. The boy was hanging upside down from the oak tree, lit by the flashing light and swaying in the wind. His blooded head was knocking on the car and his fingernails scraping the roof. "Didn't you listen to the radio?" asked the policeman. "A murderer just escaped from the mental hospital in town." This next story is called "Don't Turn On the Light," and out of all the stories I have read since I started my YouTube journey, this, my lovies, is probably one of the creepiest of them all, if I'm being honest. Let me know down in the comment section how you feel about it. Again, it's called "Don't Turn On the Light." Student halls of residence are strange places. You never know who or what you might find in your room. You don't really know the people you're suddenly living with, but everybody wants to make friends. They're always inviting themselves around, and there's no real privacy. One Friday night at a university in England, first-year student Jenny was getting excited about a freshman event that was taking place that evening. She was trying to persuade Emily, her new roommate, to come along, but later didn't feel like partying. So, eventually, Jenny left her there and went to party alone. Later that evening, she came back to the room to get something, leaving the light off so as not to wake Emily. She rolled out of bed. She saw the was hired to kill an entire family. The job went wrong, and the contract killer lost both his hands in a punishment. He was later incarcerated at a secure mental hospital out of town and was told that he would never be released. In place of his hands, the prison authorities attached two large hooks. Several years went by and people had forgotten about him until one night he escaped after murdering a guard who had taken pity on him. Bulletins went out on the local radio all night. He was highly dangerous and should not be approached. A young couple who had been driving into the country for some privacy heard the reports while they were parked in a popular location overlooking the town. They realized they had driven past a psychiatric facility only a few minutes earlier. The girl didn't want to be out at night when the killer was on the loose, but the boy told her it would be fine and that they had probably caught him by now. However, his date was having none of it, so the boy reluctantly fired up the car and drove into town, listening to the radio for updates. All the way home, they heard a knocking noise coming from somewhere on the car, which he explained right away as a regular problem. When they reached her house and got out of the vehicle, they saw what was causing that noise. A large hook was hanging on the passenger door handle, covered in blood. This story is called Behind the Mask. A child in Japan was walking home from school one evening. The friends who usually walk with her had already gone home, but she was only one street away from her house. She saw a young woman walking towards her wearing a surgical mask like those that many Japanese people wear to protect themselves from diseases. She stopped in front of the child and leaned down towards her. The child was not worried, as she seemed friendly enough. "Where are you going?" the woman asked. "I'm going home from school. My house is just down the road." "Do you think I'm beautiful?" came the unexpected question. The girl politely, if a little concerned, said, "Yes." She removed the mask. "How about now?" and revealed a horrific wound that slashed her mouth from ear to ear. She bent down to the frightened girl and asked again through her mutilated lips, "How about now?" The girl was horrified by her appearance, but she had been brought up to be always be polite, so she told her that she still looked beautiful. Then the terrifying figure disappeared. The next day at school, the girl told her friends what she had seen, and they immediately recognized the story. They told her that the woman had appeared to many girls over the years, but not all of them had been so lucky. If she hadn't said the right thing, the woman would have cut the same terrible smile into the girl's own face with a pair of scissors and condemned her to roam the streets in the mask. The shop girl did not walk home alone again for a very, very long time. This last and final story is called Clowning Around, and as many of you know, I have a fear of clowns, so this story was creepy as hell. Again, it's called Clowning Around. A couple went out for dinner one night and left their children with a new babysitter. The mother was a little unsure about her, as she was quite young and the children had not been sleeping well lately after scaring each other with stories about a boogeyman hiding in their bedrooms. She wanted to ring to check how things were going at home, but the father reassured her that it was better not to interfere. Just